The Charles D. Kelman Innovators Lecture honors the work of an individual whose creativity has advanced the art and science of ophthalmology. Over the course of his distinguished career, today's honoree has made significant contributions to our field. To introduce this year's Kelman Innovator Awardee, please welcome Mrs. Ann Kelman, the spouse of the late Charles D. Kelman and a member of the ASCRS Foundation.
Thank you. I'm delighted to be here to introduce Dr. Reay Brown. Dr. Reay Brown is a board-certified ophthalmologist specializing in glaucoma, glaucoma surgery, and cataract surgery. He has been practicing in Atlanta since 1988. The list of Dr. Brown's contribution to his field is impressive and has earned him numerous awards and recognitions, including the American Glaucoma Society's Innovators Award in 2014, the Senior Achievement Award from the American Academy of Ophthalmology in 2009, and the Distinguished Alumnus Award from the Wilmer Institute of Johns Hopkins University in 2013. Together, Dr. Brown and his wife, Dr. Mary Lynch, have been awarded 27 patents for new devices and instruments to improve glaucoma and cataract surgery, including iPass, the first trabecular bypass device implanted in humans. His first innovation, the Trabecufine, is an internal trephine that performed glaucoma filtering procedure and was a forerunner of the current aquasys procedure. He also patented a device for treating glaucoma with a transcorneal valve in 1998. That device will begin human trials in the next year. Dr. Brown is currently working with a team of scientists from Georgia Tech on advancing MIGS technology to improve efficiencies. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming the 2017 Dr. Charles Kelman Innovator Lecturer, Dr. Reay Brown. I'm here to pull him away, cause I make no mistakes. I'm on the right track today, that I would fall this way. Don't have any self-regret, not a self-being instead. I'm on the right track today, that I would fall this way. On this way, there ain't no other way.
Anne, thank you so much. The song is the theme song for this talk, and you'll see why. Anne, your work with your foundation has been amazing, and it's such an incredible way to honor Dr. Kelman. I joined the ASCRS in 1999 because I knew cataract surgery was important for glaucoma care, but I had no idea how true that would be, or how much fun it would be to be part of this group. And no organization has done as much to support MIGS and the whole MIGS revolution than the ASCRS, and I'm very grateful. Thank you very much. These are my disclosures. I've worked for most of the companies in the MIGS space, but I do not have any active contracts with any of them. My major bias is that I want all devices to work. My wife, Dr. Mary Lynch, should share in this award. We've been partners in everything, including most of the patents and the projects I'll be talking about today. Let's see if I can get the mouse. This is us operating on a pig in one of our studies, and that's true love. Phacoemulsification is the greatest invention in cataract removal, and we've heard a lot about it at this meeting. It was invented 50 years ago, but it was not widely adopted until the 90s, more than 25 years later. There was huge resistance in the 70s and 80s, especially at academic centers, and so Charlie is an inspiration for overcoming resistance and winning in the end. I invited Dr. Kelman to give a talk at Hopkins when I was chief resident, and I remember going out to dinner with him and sitting at his table and him telling stories of innovation and mesmerizing the group, especially with the challenge of how to get a 6-millimeter lens through a 3-millimeter phaco incision without extending the wound. And we were hanging on every word, and of course the answer was to fold it. I'm going to be using overcoming resistance in two ways. First, the resistance to outflow that MIGS seeks to bypass, and also resistance to using surgery to treat glaucoma. We're seeing exponential growth in glaucoma surgery driven by MIGS, and we're about at the arrow there. I have been attempting to innovate in glaucoma surgery for more than 3 decades, and most of the projects I'll be talking about today are unfortunately on the flat part of the curve, but I hope have contributed to the growth. Along the way, I'm going to be developing themes relating to the National Enquirer, this old surgery, Christopher Columbus, Peter Thiel, and cilia. I like showing this old photograph of surgery from about 1900. It reminds me that future surgeons will look at our surgery just as we look at this picture today. They'll ask, how could they have been so primitive? Where are the gloves, the hats, the masks? And this picture is very historic. It's the first example of a nurse texting during a case. Peter Thiel is famous as the founder of PayPal and the first private investor in Facebook and many other things. His favorite interview question is, tell me something that's true that almost nobody agrees with you on. When I first heard this, I said, that's easy. My answer would be that glaucoma should be a surgical disease. Absolutely a contrarian opinion. Because the glaucoma treatment paradigm is always eye drops first, laser second, surgery only as a last resort. The underlying assumption is glaucoma has to be a medical disease because surgery is too risky. It doesn't work and has too many scary complications. But the hard reality is that medical therapy also has many problems: noncompliance, recurring expense, and side effects that are best seen in patients who are taking the medication in one eye. The side effects also are very well seen in patients who have had successful surgery in one eye but are still on medical therapy in the fellow eye. Dr. Steve Obstbaum is the ASCRS glaucoma godfather. He has done so much for glaucoma in this organization. I was proud to be quoted by him in 2009 in this iWorld story saying that glaucoma should be a surgical disease. But I had believed that since 1980. And as Howard Marks says in his book, he's a very famous investor as well, being far ahead of your time is indistinguishable from being wrong. I started my training in 1979 at Johns Hopkins, where being on call meant spending the night. So I spent a lot of time in the Wilmer Library, and I found there was an extensive literature showing angle surgery lowered pressure in adult open-angle glaucoma. Both trabeculotomy and goniotomy were very popular and successful in Europe, and I wondered, why weren't U.S. surgeons doing this? Because if the resistance is in the trabecular meshwork, angle surgery makes sense to restore outflow. Meanwhile, in the 80s, vitreous surgery was just starting, and Ron Michaels was one of the pioneers, and he had an early vitrectomy cutter that had a trephine tip. This was terrible for cutting vitreous, and so he let me have it, because I thought it would be ideal for doing an internal trabeculotomy. My goal was to cut a series of holes in the meshwork, open the canal, overcome resistance, and restore outflow. It seems simple. But not so fast. This was way too far ahead of the technology. The trephine was too big, and we didn't have viscoelastic, among other things. It was just impossible. So I said, what else can I do with a tree fine cutter? At the time, the best glaucoma surgery was a trabeculectomy, which required a large conjunctival incision, a scleral incision and a flap, a second scleral incision into the chamber, iridectomy, and then closing all the incisions just right. I thought that's way too much cutting and sewing to make a hole. There must be a better way. And so I modified the vitrectomy cutter and made the glaucoma mechanical tree fine or trabecufine, and we could do the entire operation from inside the eye with one 20-gauge incision and no conjunctival wound. I was very fortunate as a resident to have the help of Jean-Marie Perel, the famous instrument maker at Bascom Palmer, in helping to create this instrument. This is from CNN before it was fake news.
Eye surgeons still aren't satisfied. New technology may provide a better route.
By applying some of this new technology,
I was wearing a wig.
For the first time, have been able to do the glaucoma operation from inside the eye.
Researchers are experimenting with tiny drills. They enter the eye from one side, then reach across to poke a small hole through just the inner layer of eye tissue. Excess fluid then escapes through this hole.
Now this is the operation. You can see the tree fine tip spinning and the small incision. We engage the sclera on the opposite side and the tree fine cuts right through and the little piece is pushed out and is in the bleb that's now pumped up by the infusion. You can see the little piece in the bleb right there. There we go. And that's the whole operation. We had a great team of investigators in this study, including three, Brad Shingleton, Rick Lewis, and Alan Crandall, who would go on to become ASCRS presidents. So an amazing group of investigators. We published many papers, and I gave a talk on this at the Science Writers Seminar. Rick Lewis was also there, and he was also giving a talk, and we both were interviewed about this operation. Little did we know that the article would appear in the National Enquirer. Under this very modest headline, new glaucoma surgery is better than ever and only takes 10 minutes. And Rick is a true friend. He said it's a fascinating idea and an excellent approach to glaucoma surgery. So despite the fanfare, you've never heard of this operation, so what went wrong? We had trouble with the hole. It was either open too much or not enough. There was scarring in the conjunctiva, and we abandoned it before we had viscoelastics or mitomycin. There just was no interest in investing in a glaucoma operation. What we needed was a device to keep the scleral hole open and control flow. And ironically, Dr. Bob Rich was part of our team, and he had invented the rivet, the Rich rivet, in 1990, which was like the Express mini shunt, except implanted inside the eye. But he never told me, and we had no chance to collaborate. If we had worked together, the GMT and the rivet would have been very much like Zen surgery only 25 years earlier. The end of the project coincided with the start of 5-FU and mitomycin attempts to modify conjunctival wound healing, but I couldn't accept that blebs were going to be the key to glaucoma surgery and my life would be full of eyes that look like this. So we went on to the glaucoma tack, a corneal drainage device that would drain aqueous directly through the cornea with no conjunctival incision. And we patented this in 1994 with Keith Thompson, a cornea specialist. The concept was to make glaucoma a microfluidics problem, not a conjunctival wound healing problem. I knew I needed help, so I pitched the idea to the two major eye companies. And this is from my pitch letter. I was calling it the glaucoma faucet. And this is the last paragraph. No company has ever made a serious commitment to solving the glaucoma surgery problem. This has created an enormous opportunity. Glaucoma patients deserve a better operation. The company that solves the problem of glaucoma surgery will be justly rewarded. And I'm sure they had a good laugh at this, you know, who talks like this, and this guy's an idiot. But that's how I felt, and I think every word is true and has come to pass. So the faucet could fix glaucoma without ever understanding outflow. We don't need to have outflow angiograms if we have controlled the pressure with something through the cornea. It's a crazy idea, but if it worked, it could solve all glaucoma worldwide. So what would it be worth? Well, I know exactly what it was worth to one of the companies because we were working on a contract, and this is a letter that they wrote me as part of the back and forth saying, what would we need to pay for the option to buy the tack? And their offer was $1. And don't spend it all in one place. And ironically, a dollar would have been enough. I just wanted support. No one had ever made any money from a glaucoma device, and that was not my expectation. I just wanted a better operation. Ultimately, both companies said no. This was the letter from the other company, which also looked at it very carefully, but the bottom line was your idea is not a good fit within our business. A similar corneal drainage patent issued 2 years later to Thad Wandel, and this was developed by BD through several FDA studies, but abandoned because of problems with infection. But this concept goes on with the startup Micro-Optics, which is currently developing the TAC concept and starting FDA trials. So back to 1995, it was still all about the bleb. But meanwhile, we had developed a MIG solution for congenital glaucoma. Historically, the main surgery had been either a trabeculotomy or goniotomy. The first operation would give 50% success by opening 120 degrees of angle. The second operation could raise it to 70% by opening another 120. The third operation could get to 90% by opening the final 120. So it took three operations to get to 90%. In our partnership, Mary did most of the congenital glaucoma, but we both agreed that 50% was just not good enough. The problem, we thought, was that we're only doing one-third of the angle at each surgery. The challenge was how to open 360 at one sitting. The answer was to pass a suture around the canal 360 and pull it into the eye. And this became the 360 suture trabeculotomy, and in one operation we could achieve 90% success with a much faster recovery of vision, less amblyopia, less myopia. And this was published with our fellow, Dr. Alan Beck, in 1995. And this built on work that had been done by Ron Fellman, and this was the precursor of GAT, which is currently being used for adult glaucoma and is being developed by Ron and his partner, Devinder Grover. Now, this is from a news story that really speaks for itself.
See the technique that allows children to undergo one surgery instead of three. Simone was born with a condition that could have led to blindness, but her mother was determined to find a cure.
You got to give them all the opportunities they can have with seeing, and especially the eyes are the most important thing.
Simone suffered from congenital glaucoma. It's still surgery, but it uses a stiff suture instead of these traditional metal probes.
The big advantages are that you can do the entire procedure in one sitting with one anesthetic.
During surgery, a suture is threaded through the drainage canal, and the ends are pulled tight. That pulls the canal into proper position so fluid can drain from the eye. For Simone, it's been a huge success.
It's just like 100%, it's like a turnover completely. Her not bumping into things anymore, her noticing everything.
Today, Simone's vision is almost back to normal. The threat of blindness is nowhere in sight.
There's nothing better than helping a child, but we still were anxious to do something in adult open-angle glaucoma. And in the late 90s, Dr. Robert Stegman was doing the most innovative glaucoma surgery with his work on viscocanaloplasty, and this is Dr. Stegman receiving this award for his work on viscoelastics. But he was taking some major heat. Academic glaucoma hated viscocanaloplasty, and the Journal of Glaucoma editorial condemned it. It was called the sartorial specter of viscocanaloplasty, and who knows what that means, but you know it's not going to be good. And in the editorial, they say, as the rest of us grope to understand whether this idea has any validity, anterior segment surgeons, weary of flip and chip, have already rushed to incorporate this new technology, quote unquote, into their practices. Most of the limited existing papers appear in the cataract and refractive surgery publications. So, Dr. Stegman, though, was undeterred and kept going, and he started planting a tube in Schlemm's canal to increase the pressure lowering. When Mary and I saw this, we thought it would be great to develop a tube that would connect the canal directly to the anterior chamber. And this became the iPass in 1999, a T-tube connecting the canal to the anterior chamber. The idea was to promote outflow in both directions. And this is an outflow study. I have an iPass on one side of the canal, and I'm going to be pushing Vision Blue into the system, and you'll see how quickly the outflow channels fill up. In a matter of seconds, the whole system is full. And we were so excited by this. We hoped that we would have more circumferential flow than perhaps we get, and this made us very excited that we might be really fixing glaucoma with a device in the canal. Stills from this movie became the cover of the MIGS issue of the JCRS. And I would like to thank Dr. Nick Mamelis, the editor, for having the courage to have a glaucoma focus for a JCRS issue. As the first bypass device, there were many questions: what size, how long, what material, should we implant outside in or inside out by itself or combined with cataract? We found if it was too big, it would split the wall and had to get down to 280 or smaller to be able to fit. We tested many designs. That's just the tip of the iceberg. Eventually, the rigid T-tube evolved into a flexible dual tube bonded at one end. This is the operation. We've unroofed Schlemm's canal, and we know exactly where we are. We're passing the tube down one side, and the other leg goes down the other side of the canal. So now we have a tube on both sides, and the bonded portion goes into the eye, and we can see the blood reflex, which tells us we're in the right spot. So we're feeling very good about this. We close it up, and as I put fluid into the anterior chamber, you'll see the tubes clear of blood, indicating that the system is working and fluid is flowing into Schlemm's canal and presumably outflow collector channels, etc. So we had a technical summit and had a very distinguished panel of advisors, including four from our previous study. Now, being first is not always best, whether you're in a cavalry charge or going to the FDA. The FDA ruled that we had to do a blind eye study. We had to implant the iPass into 10 blind eyes, so no benefit to the patients, only risk. We completed the blind eye study and three more FDA studies, but the sponsor ended the project in 2006 during our final FDA study because of financial issues. But along the way, we developed many of the fundamental patents in trabecular bypass, and we now have 16 years of follow-up on about 40 patients and have not seen any erosions, migrations, corneal decompensation, inflammation. So the iPass is a very safe and stable device. We started a multi-center German study at the end of the project, and it has just been published in the Journal of Glaucoma. It showed that the IPASS lowered the pressure in this group of patients from 26 to 16 and reduced medications from more than 2 to less than 1. But in 2007, the IPASS project had ended, the iStent was in trials and would be 5 years before approval, and CyPass, Zen, InFocus, and Hydrus were all just starting. So MIGS was in a pause. And yet it was 2008 when modern glaucoma surgery began with this landmark article showing that cataract surgery lowers pressure and the magnitude is proportional to pre-op pressure, showing that cataract surgery truly is glaucoma surgery. Academic glaucoma was very upset, but the data is overwhelming. So this was revenge of the anterior segment surgeons. And to add insult to injury, it was in a cataract and refractive surgery journal. And cataract surgery has been absolutely critical to the development of MIGS and the iStent. And it might not have happened as quickly without the support of the ASCRS, David Karcher, Don Bell, and Laura Johnson, and also the support of the crossover cataract surgeons who took a risk and started implanting a glaucoma device in the angle. But we needed a rock star, and we found him in Ike Ahmed, who named MIGS in 2012, and he did the impossible. He made it cool to do glaucoma. I have thought a lot about why the iStent succeeded and the iPass did not, and part of the reason is a business concept called the Columbus effect. Columbus thought he had discovered part of India, China. He never knew he had landed on islands between two continents unknown to Europeans. He was looking for gold and spices and ignored the crops and the natural resources that were much more valuable. The point is the first person often misunderstands the real market and misses the opportunity. And our sponsoring company was going after refractory glaucoma, the small group of patients doing very poorly. We wanted to replace trabeculectomy. We were going from the outside in. We were not combining with cataract. But Glaukos saw it very differently. They were going for mild to moderate glaucoma, not replacing trabeculectomy, but replacing eye drops. They were going from the inside out, and they were combining with cataract. And this was all contributed to their success. But maybe the bottom line is that they had Tom Burns as the CEO and Bill Link on the board of directors, and that was the difference. Because their vision of targeting mild to moderate glaucoma changed everything. We can gauge the severity of glaucoma by how many drops a patient takes. Almost 50% take one drop, 30% two drops, 18% on three drops, and 5% on four or more. Before MIGS, surgical candidates came from the small group 5%. But MIGS works best in the 95% on 1 to 3 drops, the mild to moderate group. And this flips the market. Instead of 5%, it's 95%. And data shows that 20% of patients undergoing cataract surgery have a concurrent diagnosis of glaucoma. So if there are 4 million cataract operations, that means 800,000 candidates for a MIGS device instead of the 75,000 receiving a trab or tube. The increasing MIGS volume has been great for the glaucoma device market, which is the line going almost straight up and is now more than $3 billion. The days of a device for a dollar are really over. So let's go back to this headline, which was crazy in 1989, but now it understates what we're doing with MIGS today. And let's stick with crazy. Which idea was crazier in 2014? That Donald Trump would be president, or that Glaukos would have a market cap of $1.7 billion? There have been 3 FDA approvals for glaucoma devices in the last 5 years, the iStent, the CyPass, and the Zen. Each has a different mechanism, and that's highly remarkable. In the next 1 to 2 years, we're going to see approval of the Hydrus, the iStent Inject, and the iStent Supra, and we already have a number of great other options. So are we there yet? Is glaucoma a surgical disease? In this quote, I say it should be, but only when we have a safe and effective procedure. We have safety, but what about efficacy? How well does the iStent, for example, lower the pressure? And I looked at this in this article. I found that the average pressure reduction was 3.2, and if we stratify by pre-op pressure, the effect increases, so that if the pressure is greater than 21, the average pressure reduction was 7.5. But the problem is we don't know how much is the cataract and how much is the iStent. The CyPass was approved in 2016 and has a similar issue. The IOP reduction at 2 years was a very impressive 7.0, but the cataract alone was 5.3. And the problem, I think, is that we implant MIGS tubes and we expect passive flow to lower the pressure. This is very safe, but passive flow may not be enough. The question is, how can we get active flow like we see in the movie? I think we need a pump. Nature's pump is cilia, and they're everywhere, and they're amazing. So I've been working with a group at Georgia Tech on pseudocilia activated by a rotating magnet, and you can see the sound of one cilia beating there. And we can line these up. They can be made very small, 100 microns. And we line them up in rows, and we can do a closed loop or an open loop. This is a series of rows. And as we increase the speed of the magnet, you can see the cilia beat. And we gauge the speed with nanoparticles that are fluorescent. And you can see how fast they go as we speed it up. And it can really get some very powerful forces generated. These are beating so fast you can't see them move at all. And you can see the power that they can generate. So there are many questions. What size? How many? How close together? What speed? Fortunately, the math is very simple. And I think every MIGS device could be pumped. And if this is like our other product, our other projects, it'll be a product in 10 or 15 years, but for someone else. By any measure, the impact of glaucoma surgery is increasing. We've always had the unmet need, but now we have the key ingredients of investment, dollars, and competition. There's no question that MIGS is changing the glaucoma treatment paradigm, more surgery, earlier surgery. And MIGS, like phaco, to finish up this talk, looks obvious in retrospect, but took years for development, years for acceptance. And Dr. Kelman is still our inspiration. He led the small incision revolution in cataract surgery and everything else, and has really solved cataract. MIGS has been more of a team sport, and glaucoma is definitely not solved. We need more innovation, and MIGS has been great, but one of the finest things about MIGS is that it gives us hope for the future that one day we will solve glaucoma. And I want to say thank you to my many friends and the inspiration they give me. And this is just the tip of the iceberg. And my family, Annie and Veronica, our two daughters. Annie is here today. She works for the New York Times. And, of course, Mary. This is the pig that we're operating on. You can see the hoof. And I ask you, how many couples have a picture like this? Or wish they did? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Brown, for that outstanding talk, and I think you have a second career on a comedy show. This is the conclusion of the Innovator session. Please enjoy the rest of our meeting.